Good morning to one and all. On behalf of Faculty of Pharmacy, Ramayya University of Applied Sciences, I, Gauri Nair, Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmacology, extend a warm welcome to all of you for the webinar session, Drug Discovery in the Multi-Omic Era. It's my privilege to introduce to you all our eminent speaker, Dr. Jaykant. Dr. Jaykant was graduated from PhD College of Pharmacy in 2007. And completed his M.Pharm in Pharmacology at Shastra University in 2010. He was awarded PhD in Biochemical Pharmacology at Pondicherry University in 2018. He worked as a CSIR Senior Research Fellow at Pondicherry University for more than 5 years and as Associate Professor at PhD College of Pharmacy, Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu. Currently, Dr. Jaykant is working as Assistant Professor in the School of Pharmacy and Technology Management, SBKMS, NMIMS University, Telangana. Dr. Jaykant possesses skills and technical expertise in various fields like flow cytometry, fluorescence activated cell sorting, mass spectroscopy, and in silico drug discovery. He has published several research papers with a cumulative impact factor of 22.35. and has won Indian patent to his credit. With this brief introductory note, once again, I would like to welcome you all to our webinar. Now, I request Dr. Jaykant to deliver the talk. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, Gauri madam, for a nice introduction about me. And shall I proceed with the presentation?
Yes, sir. Sure.
Is my screen is visible, madam?
Yes, sir, it's visible. You can proceed.
Yeah, thank you, Dhamaran. Okay, a warm welcome and good morning to everyone. So they have given me an introduction. I have few expertise on drug discovery lane and omics platform as well. So today I am going to give you the strategies which are followed in drug discovery in this multi-omics era. Because in the multi-omics era, you can see humongous data are coming inside. It's very hard to drill and to find out the indrained roots what is present. So it seeks a well thought out and well sought out strategies in order to define its network into the meaningful or sensible one. So in that note, this presentation was made and I'll try to give my maximum justice for your understanding. So do before it becomes late is the mantra. So we need to know what we have to do and why we have to do. So all these things are addressed. And this presentation is from the inspiration of the presentation given by Ronald J. Christopher. He's an eminent drug person in the drug discovery, and he is an eminent scientist. So the most important question which is throbbing in our mind whenever we think about the drug discovery or anything else is why, how I have multiple datas, how I can organize these datas to a meaningful or sensible one which will make a real sense. So these are the fundamental questions which are throbbing. And you started asking why question. Obviously, the things are to lane. So the more amount of clarity will make you more wise and more clear so that you can make out the strategies in your own way, and it will come out as a revelation. So before getting into the drug discovery in this multi-omics era, let us brief you about what's the process so that the fundamental or the history or the evaluation will make you to understand what is actually happening in this real-time era. So the first question is, how does a chemical become a drug? Do this process is simple? The question comes whether it is a simple process or whether it is a complex process. Yes, it's not so simple. It's a complex process. Why it is complex? We'll list out what are the things, what are the factors makes it more complex. First is that it's a huge attrition rate you can see when it comes to drug discovery. So many things will fail when you are progressing forward. So the success rate is very, very less. So we can climb it. It's a huge attrition rate phenomenon. And then you can also see it is a putative transmogrification process. So which means that large number of different disciplines has to work together to make it as a bigger and meaningful and a successful one. And the pre-marketing phase of drug cycle is always humongous. It's time consuming. And we have to proceed everything which is codified in ICH. So we can't defer from that, have to be in compliance with that ICH and regulatory affairs. So what it says is a large integrative approach is needed for the drug discovery to be a successful one. So this is about the brief introduction about what is the complexity which is residing in. So it's a huge attrition rate process. So someone have to dare to get inside. Okay, next is design and serendipity. Next question, how they do? What are the serendipities which are involved? How the medicines are discovered? When it's about the drug discovery, the first question comes inside the mind is how the medicines are discovered. Yes, there are three processes by which the medicines are discovered. One is by indigenous transfer of knowledge from our system of medicine, like traditional system of medicine or alternative system of medicine, or from the treaties which we have, where the signs and symptoms will be listed, which can be very well correlated with the clinical disorders or disease which we have defined now. So that makes sense in discovery, like indigenous transfer of knowledge. Even now, today, the indigenous transfer of knowledge will always gain 60% of success in drug discovery process. Then out of human experience, like doctrine of signature, one concept is there, like out of the human experience, working on different things, they may can come up with a new discovery of drugs, or by drug discovery by chance, like serendipitous way of drug discovery, discovery by chance. We have many examples of drugs which have been discovered by chance. Okay, so these are the three important components or the integrals in the drug discovery. So we have to put our head in any one of these things and have to take it. That was erstwhile it was happening like that, but the things have dramatically changed. There was a huge paradigm shift in the drug discovery environment. When that drug discovery environment had a huge paradigm shift is when we have a technological and biological breakthrough, in the sense we have technologies like mass spectroscopy, MSMS, mass tandem spectroscopy, where you can do proteomics, where you can do phosphoproteomics, lipidomics, glycomics, metabolomics, all the omics and next generation sequencing, where you can do the genomics. So by looking at the data, even though the data are humongous, when you put all the data together, you can able to see the ingrained roots of the pathological process of a disease. So once the ingrained roots are defined well and well, you can target the disease in a more precise way. That's why we used to say this is an era of tailor-made or patient-centered or precision medicine. So we are making a tailor-made. There is no one-size-fit-for-all or fit-for-all concept. Here everything is tailor-made and evidence-based medicine, we are speaking the evidence-based medicine. And the evidence-based medicine is constantly having a greater transition towards the progression because of understanding the ingrained roots of pathology. What's the difference between the normal cells or the normal tissue and the pathological one or the diseased one? So these helps, these differentiation, minor distinctions, the minor nuances, really helping us to discover large amount of drugs, biomarkers, and other things. In the way, this omics era helps us to define the disease properly and helps us to curb the undesired or unwanted side effects because of multiple targeted drugs or extracts, which is having the different kinds of ligands inside. So, today, the medicines directed to an identified pathological process, or we are going towards the specific target. So if your medicine is well targeted, then it is very well safe and it will produce a very good efficacy, and you can also see the side effects are limited. So do no harm, the final mantra will be justified. So out of this technological advancements and out of this humongous data, the lot many technologists have put forth a clear-cut network. So you can see I have displayed one of the network which we have recently worked on, the CHEK1. This is the process of the cell cycle. You will be studying in your book the simplified or the very much slimmed cell cycle one. This is also slimmed, but you can see the interconnectivity and all these things where they can give you the key nodes where we can really put our heat. Okay, something is happening with this. My interested kinase is this one, how it is getting interacted, and either I can look for the upstream or the downstream effector, and finally my endpoint I can look what actually happening and which phase these are processing. So this is one of the database from where they have curated the data from the experiments and all the predicted ones. So this is a curated database, CHEK database, everyone will be aware about it, which helps us to refine and to read further to in order to understand the ingrained roots of the pathological process. You can see the complex things are made into a simplified network here. So now let's get into the real sense of the economics. Whatever we do, finally it has to give the economics, because we are in the age of homo economicus. Yes. Next, if you look at the economics and the timeline, so for the drug discovery to the investigational new drug development, it takes minimum period of 1 to 5 years. From IND to NDA, or if it is a biological BLA, it takes minimum period of 6 years. For the review and approval after regulatory submission, it will approximately take 1.1 years. So overall, it is consuming more than 12 years. And let us look at the budget, how much is invested here. So for the new drug, it's $1.3 billion have been invested. Okay, after investing this much amount of money, why this much amount of money is invested? Really, it is a greater thing. Let us have the success rate of drug development. Let us have a look at the success rate of the drug development process. So, candidates for a new drug to treat a disease might include 5,000 to 10,000 chemical compounds. So, initially, when we are at the lower validation state, I'll explain you about the lower validation state, what is mean by that in the coming slide. So we will first end up with 5,000 to 10,000 compounds. Next, we have the stringent screening procedure. From that, we'll get 250 compounds. Then in non-clinical phase, obviously 10 compounds will be selected and it will be entering into the human trial. From the human trial, based upon the pre-formulation and all the interactions, we'll be getting 1 in 1,000 compounds. So if you look at the percentage of success, it's 0.001%. Yes, the cost which is involved is $1.3 billion. So this you should understand so that we can put our where we should look at and how to start, where to start, which is the scratch that we are working on. So these basic ideas give you about what is actually the drug discovery and how much money is involved in that. Let's come to our part as being a scientist and the students, academicians. We always thinking about discovering something. Actually, how the discoveries goes on. If you look at the validation rate of R&D, focus on the validation of targets. So usually it starts from the low validation to the high validation. We always think about low validation to the high validation. High validation involves the human subjects, whereas the lower validations gradually proceeds from in vitro to the next higher organism, the in vivo. In the next higher organism in in vivo, we have two things. One is the smaller laboratory animals. In other per se, we'll be having the larger animals. So like that, whenever we start a research, we should always focus on low validation state to the high validation state. So always define your ground zero, where you are going to work out, whether you are going to start your work from here, or whether you are going to start from work from here, or anything beyond the base where we can predict certain things. So define your ground zero. So ideally, most of the people in this era starts from the in silico platform. So because of the structural biology has gained a greater importance, from there we start, and then we'll proceed with the next validation state in vitro, and then in vivo, then goes to the clinical, and finally launch of drug. So whenever we plan for an experiment, we should always look where we are starting it. So define your ground zero. I'll keep on reiterating that define your ground zero. The ground zero is in vitro, ideally. So you can go with a prediction and then you can go with the in vivo. I'll also show the tires, how they will screen exactly in the industrial pipeline. Okay, now let's break it and let's see the drug discovery process. So for target identification, if it is a new target, for target identification itself, it will take 1 to 3 years. So because they have to identify the targets and that they have to validate that target in the human being and make sure that that's a unique target, especially for that biological process. So target identification is very, very important key and where everything is residing. So you have to identify a valid target. That's so important. So keep in mind the valid target is very, very important. And second thing is, after target identification, then we'll proceed with the lead generation. So there are different procedures. I'll show you what are the procedures, strategies adapted in lead generation. So it will take 1 to 2 years. Then we have to optimize the lead based upon the PK and PD. So that lead optimization will minimal take 1.5 years to 2.5 years. Then obviously it will go into the preclinical development and the formal developmental phase of the clinical trial will be proceeded. So always the lead generation and preclinical development will be in interactions or interrelations. So anything goes wrong, they will add and this may get extended. So the most important which you have to remember is the target identifications. And the most important thing is 70% of all marketed drugs results from R&D efforts on previously a clinically validated target. So 70% of the drugs which is emerging are already validated target. Only 30% are emerging with the new targets. So those we defined it as the first in class. So all these things I'll come up. So the key word here is the target identification and already previously clinically validated target is very important when you go for the drug discovery process. So define your ground zero here well and good. Next comes the compound selection. So how the biologist and chemist will look at the drug or the target choice. A good target has distinctively different meaning in the per se of biology and the chemistry personnel. How the biologist will look at the target. A good target should somehow intercept in the biological pathway in order to give a meaningful therapeutic outcome. Whereas if you look at the chemist, he will be always thinking about it should be a orally active small molecules which can give you a good biological response or biological pathway. They'll be thinking more on the pharmacokinetic aspect, whereas the biologist will always have a look on the pharmacodynamic aspects. So interplay of these two disciplines, the chemistry and the biology, can only lead to the eventual success. So always have an integration with the chemist and the biologist to have a meaningful success. So keep it in mind, the biologist will always think at the dynamic angle, whereas the chemist will always look at the orally available. So it's highly the patient have the very good compliance and good market value as well. So that these two will really make sense. So biology and chemistry has to go hand in hand in terms of drug discovery. Yes, we have to predefine this when we plan for a drug discovery. Yes, I'm going to put maximum heat on drug discovery. So, or if you are planning for a project or whatever it may be. So these are the key important points which has to be kept in mind. So before doing the thing, the typical compound criteria in research, how it will be defined. So this is how they'll do in industry. So first thing is they are going to focus on first in class or best in class. So for the target, you are going to define the drug first time. So first in class. So it is a unique everything. Best in class, there are already marketed products are available, marketed drugs are available. So I'm going to overcome the limitations which is present in the marketed products in terms of pharmacokinetics or dynamics or combined together. So the key here is where you are going to focus on. First, you have to define, yes, I'm going to focus on clinically validated target, but no drug is available. We are going to work on that drug means. Then it's first in class, already available. We are going to do something to overcome the limitations associated with already available drug is called as best in class. But whenever you go for the best in class, it should be kept in mind. It should be structurally unique molecule, either first or best in class. So it should be structurally unique. Then only you can go for patent and you can have all the royalties to your packet. So otherwise it will infringe the other's patent claim. So generally they'll always look for the structurally unique molecules. So first in class criteria. And third thing is the potencies. If I'm going for the best in class, what should I keep in mind? The potency that meets or exceeds the gold standard in terms of solid pharmacology. And then second thing we should keep in mind is the target selectivity, because whatever target you chose, AR receptor and an enzyme, it obviously come from a family where they have the homologs of that family. So it should be thousandfold. Generally they'll keep a criteria like it should be thousandfold more selective than the closely related targets. So that is also important. If the target is a single, it's not having the close related family or the homology is not resides in the domain region, then it's well and good. It's up to you how to look at the structure and predict it. So that second point is target selectivity should be greater than 1,000 folds versus closely related targets. And efficiency in relevant animal models is important. Keep in mind the efficiency in relevant animal model. I'll show you some of the cases why they have used this animal model and what is the rationale behind using this animal model. So relevant animal model to have the meaningful clinical endpoints that can be very well correlated with that of the pathological process of the human being. And in terms of drug metabolism and pharmacokinetics, yes, the drug should not, whatever you are going to produce, should not have drug-drug interaction liabilities, and it is suitable for oral dosing and limited metabolism with the prominent 5-cytochrome P450 enzymes and the robust efficacy in rodent autoimmune disease model. So these are the important three criteria which we wish everybody will keep in the industry to go forward for the drug discovery. So the meaningful thing is, so if you are planning for best in class, the potency should meet the gold standard or it should exceed the gold standard. The selectivity should be greater than 1,000 folds with the related targets. And eventually you have to use the animal model. Always try to have an ideal, no drug-drug liabilities suitable for the oral dosage form that will always give you the compliances and limited metabolism. Yes, now this slide is also very important when we focus on the drug discovery, because we don't know where actually we are in and what actually we are doing. So when I look at my students, they'll be telling they don't know from where it has come from. So actually from where they are doing, what is actually the cycle? What is the strategy they are adapting? So the strategy is very simple. I have made it highly simplified way so that you can able to understand. So drug discovery starts from here, since we have the very good in silico platform and good advancement in the structural biology, we have the very good in silico platform. So in terms of in silico platform, we can design the drugs from shapes and fragments. Point number one, where the fragment based drug discovery helps up. I'll discuss about it. I'll give some key nuances of it. And then scaffold morphing. Yes, already known inhibitors, they'll try to morph so that they'll go with the minimal successful rate that if this scaffold is present, obviously it will possess the activity. Then the virtual screening, de novo design is up to as a very new design, and the bias library screening from different libraries and from known inhibitors, and then compound screening, that's US FDA. So the screening has the multiple segments or multiple dimension inside the shapes and fragments from where we can shape the take the shapes and fragments. So here you have to keep the maximum sense. So the shapes and fragment libraries are there. And apart from that, for example, if your plant product is showing the efficacy and it is having the complex structure, always try to break it into fragments and try to use the bigger fragments and look at the activity where everything, the key resides. I'm just explicitly exposing the ostensible things to you. So likewise, from the human metabolome, you can take it. And then a scaffold morphing, as I said already, biased by libraries, you can look at the metabolomics data, all different data from the plants, metabolomics data, from the metabolome of human being, HMDB. And then from the known inhibitors, there is another one method where they'll adapt the pharmacophore generations, like mapping the skeletons or mapping the key interacting features. Thereby, they can able to come up with the diversified chemical structures which may possess the activity. And compound screening already approved by FDA, the repositioning or repurposing will come into the picture. So you can try all. Or you can, if you are more based upon the objective which we have in the research, we can go with that. So once that is done, what are the things will be go hand in hand? What are the things that go hand in hand is once this is done, and if it is a drug which is already available, we will obviously get it, and we will go for biochemical assay or cell-based screening in order to show whether it is able to inhibit or not. And we will be able to identify the IC50, how far it is able to inhibit it, if it is a kind of inhibitor. So if it is having the inhibitory activity at a very low concentration in the nanomolar, then we'll be highly interested to make it into a crystal lattice, and then we'll go for the X-ray diffraction in order to predict how it is interacting. So that is also will make higher sense. Now you can say, apart from X-ray, cryo-EM has helped, and I hope in near years, or you will be getting almost the surface, plasma proteins, and the targets which is residing in the plasma proteins will be loaded soon because of the advantage by using the cryo-EM from the X-ray and NMR. So after that, based upon the from the predicted from X-ray complex, doing the X-ray crystallography after getting the identified structure of the protein and inhibitor, you can further do the lead optimization to increase the efficacy. Then you can go for the synthesis. And then again, this cycle will be keep on repeating. This cycle will be keep on repeating until up till you come up with a desirable and what criteria, which is whatever criteria you pose initially, if it matches, obviously it will, we will end up and we'll come with a different number of compounds and we'll proceed with DMPK study, in vivo DMPK study, in vivo pharmacodynamic study, and then developability criteria such as P450, HER2, all these things, different panels will come into the picture, and finally we'll have the leads and we'll proceed for the further investigations. So this is the lead generation strategies. Just I have given the overview from what are the different libraries available, how you should start. Once you found out the ligand, you should go with a biochemical and cell-based assay. If it is showing activity at the nanomolar, it's always advisable to crystal that and look at the X-ray diffraction and get the insights on how the interaction features, where you can further go and refine it, and you can synthesize n number of compounds, and this vicious cycle keep on repeating, and it will become a vicious cycle at one point, and you can get into the downstream of in vivo DMPK PD and the drug development criteria, and we can finally come up with a lead. So this is a very important slide. So here as I said, the developmentability criteria. So what are that criteria? How the research testing cascade goes on? Yes, now I, after biochemical staining and other things, you can see it is divided into three tiers for your simplification. So initially, yes, I have synthesized the compound and it is showing the activity. Again, we will try to do the series of compounds which come out of that with receptor binding, if it is a receptor is a target. And keep in mind, you look at the values, the standard values. We always look for the drugs which is showing the efficacy at less than 10 nanomolar, then it is well and good. It can be easily transferable to the clinic or translatable to the clinic. And the most important, solubility is also important, that it should be 0.1 to 0.2 milligram per ml in aqueous of pH 7. That also you should keep in mind. And then the mouse, human liver microsome, and then mouse liver microsome, rat liver microsome, you should add the drug and make sure that your drug T half is more than 60 minutes, then only it can be it holds the value for going to the next level. And the HERG binding is very, very important. Otherwise, that potassium channel, if the potassium channel is modulated at the very low doses, obviously it will, in clinic it will, or in animals, it will prolong the QT interval. Obviously it will end up with the sudden heart death and trisodi points. These things you can come across. So it should be greater, more than 10 micromolar concentration need to be required in order to inhibit the HERG binding. So that is also the most important criteria. And then they'll always look for the enzyme inhibition and induction in terms of human 5 major, or it is the substrate for any one of the enzyme or not, that will be also be ruled out. So human 5 major P450 microsomal enzymes will be done. So, and then the mini Ames test in order to look at whether there is the possibility of carcinogenicity possibility is there or not, the mutagenicity or carcinogenic potential of the compound will be assessed by using the mini Ames test. And apart from that, calostogenic potential should also be added now in the recent guidelines. So you have to look at the chromosomal aberration as well as the mini Ames test is highly advisable now. So the first tier of screening, after performing all these tests, from we have the handful of 1,000 compounds which is having the activity, have now reduced to 100, for example. So for this 100, again, they will go for the second tier studies. See, you just have look at how from low validation, even in the low validation, we have the subunits of low validation to the higher validations. So in the second tier studies, the oral efficacy and dose response in animals will be performed, and it should, and it has to show the effective dose 50 should be 1 milligram per kilogram. If it is showing animal, it's well and good. That's the standard criteria. Then they'll also perform the mouse pharmacokinetics and dynamic study, and single dose IV or per oral in SD rats and mouse. And they'll also perform the cardiotoxicity study, the HERG channel inhibition, and CEREP panel. That's a kinases. We have handful of kinases because kinases are very important in the biological process. So studying whether they have the effect on the kinases panel is also very, very important. Otherwise, the integral metabolic process in our body will be inhibited. So kinase panel studies is also very, very important. Apart from that, Ames mutagenicity study should also be followed. So once that is done, we can reduce the compound of 100 to 5. So in third tier, what they will do? So the primary disease model. So we should always look at the primary disease model or valid disease model. If you really want more important details on that, the USFDA have defined what are the valid animal models for the conditions related to human beings, so that you can pick the models. And also many foreign laboratory have displayed in their website about the models and their correlation with the clinical pathology. So you can choose the valid animal model in mouse and rat efficacy you can show, and then in vitro metabolism, and you should all look at the metabolite, what are the metabolites which are generated, the metabolic IDs as well. then increase dose escalation and look at the pharmacokinetics, how whether it is following the first order, zero order, whatever kinetics you can do with single dose and dose escalation. So all these things can be performed. And single dose IV and PO in dogs. So now, see inside here also, they are moving from the laboratory animals to the higher animals. They'll be doing the IV and peroral in dog, monkey, and PD parameters will be assessed. And more importantly, they'll be assessing the cardiovascular activity in dogs. And rodent telemetry will also be done in order to look at the vital signs, especially the cardiac vital signs, what's happening. And finally, if everything goes well, and if we have some high number of drugs, for example, then the pharmaceutical sciences will come into the play and they'll make the solid state testing, pre-formulation strategy, crystalline amorphous, all this pre-formulation strategy, stabilities, everything will come into the picture. And finally, it'll go for IND filing. So I have given you some glimpses about how actually the industrial R&D works on and how we should focus on, where we need to start. So which is ground zero for us? So choose wisely and do it wisely. This is what I can say. Yes. Now, whatever we have seen in kind of theoretical one, it will make you more sense if you understand some case example associated with that. So I have taken the case of allogliptin and I'm going to discuss on that so that you can able to understand how they have approached, what are the various animal models and how they have translated that allogliptin in the market. So I have confined my presentation up to the animal model. I didn't go for the human being. So after understanding the structural biology, as I said, no, after the advent of lot many technologies, the higher end techniques, so it has exposed the key nuances which is present in the structural biology part. So this structural biology helps meaningful in drug discovery, and even these understandings now have been translated in artificial intelligence, which is booming now. So by increasing in the role in understanding of the disease have made many new medicines. You can see a few of them. And for that, I have taken an example, as I said, allogliptin. So it is coming under the DPP-4 inhibitors. Yes, it's long back, it is approved, but it could be a classical example how this allogliptin come into the picture. So it's an anti-hyperglycemic agent. And this is a drug, the DPP-4 inhibitor. Now it's an interesting thing, which always we used to think about it. So how they have come up with this idea? What make them? So when they give the glucose orally in the clinic, it stimulates the increase insulin release. When the doctor give glucose in IV, it is not stimulating the insulin release. So the physician will be reporting that, yeah, when oral glucose triggers the release or the amplification of the insulin, whereas if the glucose is given IV, it is not triggering the release of insulin. So why this differentiation, why this distinction is happening? So from the bedside, the physician thought about it. What's actually the difference? So eventually, you should always keep in mind that the problems come from the bedside. Problem arises from the bedside, or the key resides in the bedside, where it will be translated into the bench, and the will go from the bench to the bedside. So it's actually a cycle. It's not from bench to the bedside and bedside to the bench. So it's a bedside to the bench, and from bench to the bedside, the solution will be given for the problem. So initially the physician thought about what's the difference. Then they started looking at the different metabolic and the omics data or whatever it may be. They come up with one thing, that GLP-1 is high. So which, when we look at the different factors or different factors inside, so they have come up with that glucagon-like peptide 1 level is high when they are giving the oral glucose when compared to that of the glucose which is given IV. So what is the role of this GLP-1? So they started analyzing that. If you look at the role of GLP-1, you can see here the pathway, what are the different downstreams. So it binds with its receptor and it mediating a different downstream process. The ultimate thing is the insulin secretions. It stimulates the insulin secretion or amplifies the glucose induced insulin release. So, but they found out that GLP-1 is rapidly broken down by the DPP-4. So this is an enzyme which is coming and breaking this GLP-1. So the effect of this GLP-1 is long lasting for a small period of time. If we prolong this GLP-1 for a long period of time, so that the concentration of the GLP-1 will be high. If you make the concentration of GLP-1 as high, then obviously this signaling cascade will be activated for a long period of time. And this can mediate the insulin release. So this is how they come with the solution for the treatment. So everything resides in the bedside. So look at the problems. We can easily define the solutions. Okay. So the problem is in one line. What's the difference? Why it's high? Why it's low? And we ask, when we start asking how and why question on that, we can able to find out new solutions where the novelty resides. So this is a key pipeline which they have adapted. So like they have a target now. The target is, they have validated the target that DPP-4 is a very good target, clinical target. So now they are defining the molecules for the target. After that, they are going for enzyme and ligand binding assay. They have their own set of criteria. And then ligand selection, as I mentioned, the tier 1, tier 2. And then finally, it's going for the clinical phase for IND enabling studies. So I'll come to that. We'll see the parts and parcel of each and everything. So what they have did is, yes, they want to study about, they found out that DPP-4 is very important. So by using, as I said, X-ray crystallography, they went and they just looked at the structure of DPP-4. So once you analyze the structure of DPP-4, it will expose you where the peptidase or where the targets or the domain resides. So how it is operating? What is the nature of the target? Once you look at the nature of the target, we can very well able to design the drug in whatever virtual means we have, and then we can execute very well. So the first thing is, whenever you got a target, you try to look at the target and define it, the target, whether it has, how many targets are residing, which is a key target, how it is getting modulated, is there any PTM is involved in that, everything you should have a keen look. For that, X-ray crystallography is important. And here I have shown how it works and how it operates on the X-ray crystallography. So after making the lattice, they will subject the crystal. So, and then they'll predict the structure. I am not going to go in depth inside. So now they have looked at the structure of the protein and enzyme, and now they are defining their criteria. So the absolute criteria, what they are fixing. Yes, it should be highly selective and more potent. And there should not be no cytochrome P450 interactions. And it should, we should make a drug which can be once daily dosing. And it need to be orally active. And since we have competitors, it should be super efficacy. And it should also possess safety profile. So it is superior efficacy is very important. And they have also kept the relative criteria. Equivalence or superior to best known competitors, that is DPP-4 inhibitors, on all significant parameters. On all significant parameters, we should make sure that the drug which they are going to, that is alogliptin, need to be superior or equivalent. And they have also defined the key competitors and looked at what's the pharmacokinetics and dynamics of the key competitors as well. The key competitors here is Galvus and Genovia. So the overall goal is a best in DPP-4 inhibitors is the overall goal they have get. They have kept and they have come up with the excellent DPP-4 alogliptin inhibitor. So as I said, they have started with the X-ray crystallography. So they always have a comparison with that of this already available drug, the vidagliptin, and they look at how it is interacting. So is there any additional interaction and whether that interaction itself in increasing the affinity towards the target or not. So this gives you a lot many insights once you get into it. And second thing is they have looked at the different structures of the marketed drugs, and they have to make sure, because as I said, the criteria two is it has to have the unique chemical structure. So you can look at here, the allogliptin is having the unique chemical structure. Yes, the structure is unique, it can be patentable, it can be translated, and so they are well and good with that. Then, as I said, when you are looking at the enzyme binding assay, it's not only we should do it in the known targets, the targets that DPP4, we should also look at the family members and the closely related homologs of that DPP4. Here, the closely related homologs are FAP alpha, DPP2, DPP8, DPP9, PERP, and tryptase. So you should not restrict with this one only. You should look at the biological role of all these inhibitors, because they'll be contributing the most important role in the fundamental process of the cells. So you should look at the biological role and make sure that our drug is inhibiting the greater level towards DPP4 than the homologs, so that the biological process will be overruled, or else it will end up in a long term, it will end up with a major side effects. So we need to define each and everything properly before designing everything. So yes, they have did, they have defined it. Now they started the experiment. The first claim is it has to be more potent and selective. You just look at here, the allogliptin, when compared to the other two marketed drugs, it is showing the activity in the biochemical assay, it is showing the activity at the nanomolar concentration. So the criteria one is done. And if you look at the criteria two, it should be more selective towards the target than the closely related targets. You can see here, allogliptin. So when compared to that of the closely related targets, you can see the fold. So as I said, the minimal criteria is 1,000 folds. You can see how many folds it is greater. So nothing, it's highly selective towards to DPP4. And if you look at the closely related targets, DPP2, DPP8, DPP9, and all these things they have tested, biochemical assay, and they have found out certain limitations with that of the other drugs which is existing there, so that they can make a tall claim that it's highly selective and potent when compared to, so it can hold something with the best in class which are available in terms of potency and selectivity. The claim one is done, or the criteria one is done. Now, yes, it's almost done in terms of biochemical assay. Now they'll go for the pharmacology. So whenever you look at the pharmacology, if your drug is working, it has to inhibit DPP4. If the DPP4 is inhibited, the GLP-1 level need to be high. This is a mechanistic endpoint, we used to say. There are different endpoints whenever we perform an assay. So if you look at the mechanistic endpoints, one is if you give the drug, the DPP4 activity need to be low. And parallelly, if it is low, then the GLP-1 level, the chemical reaction, whatever you say. So they have did, and they have found out that, yes, it is reducing DPP4 activity and increasing the level of GLP-1. The climb one or the endpoint one is defined clearly, and it was. So always when you are planning for an experiment, define your endpoint precisely. First endpoint need to be based on the mechanisms you propose. Keep it in mind. And you can also look at what the animal model they are using. I'll come to that. It's a non-obese and then streptozotocin-induced model. I'll come to that, why they have used, when we speak on that note. And second criteria, yes, now the GLP-1 level is high. So the GLP-1 level, if it is high, what it will do? It will make the insulin level to go high, so that obviously insulin will act in glucose in the periphery, and it will reduce the blood glucose level. As we have said, if you give glucose through oral route, it will increase or it will stimulate the insulin release. That's a fundamental concept. So now they have the claim to that. So they give the oral OGT, oral glucose tolerance test. They have subjected those animals and they have given alogliptin. So the plasma glucose level is reduced and the insulin and also it is increasing the plasma insulin level. So first claim they have defined it is inhibiting. If it is GLP is high, obviously this will lead to increase in insulin level. So insulin is getting increased. And the second endpoint is the effect in terms of the or the marker or the this is a gold standard marker, no? Glucose is a gold standard marker. The level of glucose is a gold standard marker for diabetes. So the glucose is down. So their claim two is done. So be precise in what you are defining when it comes to the animal model. Yes, done. So now the bigger question comes, what will happen to the normogenic? The people who are normal or whether it will affect anything on the fasting blood glucose level in normal ST rat. So what they have kept is in normal rats, they have given the fasting glucose they look at after giving this and it is not showing the major reduction. So they are claiming that. So it is adaptogenic, so nothing will happen. So it won't produce any hypoglycemic episodes. So see the claim three, how interestingly they have made the claim and working on that. And then come to the claim four. We know that most of the diabetes will be associated with obesity. If there is obesity, obviously you can see the manifestations of insulin resistance. So obesity, insulin resistant, type 2 diabetes. So these are the key components or the key clinical features of type 2 diabetes in obese patients, which is an ideal model. Let me look at it. Yes, the ideal model is DBDB mouse, where it has the leptin receptor mutations. So this model can be utilized and we can make a claim that if it is working, obviously it will work for the patients with obese and diabetes who have the insulin resistance, the type 2 diabetes, exactly. So they have did on DBDB mouse, and what they are doing is here, they are just looking how the same, the criteria, DPP-4 activity and GLP-1 level, whether it is decreasing or increasing. Yes, similarly, what they have hypothesized, the same thing is happening. And they are also looking at the levels of in multiple doses, single doses they are looking at, and then in multiple doses also they are looking at. So, and then if you look at here, now they have switched over to the another model. These are the valid models you should keep in mind. OB, obese mice model. Why they have went for the OB mouse model? So these mice, you can look at here, these mice display progressive food intake, insulin resistant and moderate increase in blood glucose level. These strains can be used to be the model pre-diabetic condition. Whether this drug can be used in the pre-diabetes condition or impact glucose tolerance. So during that time we can use it. Whether the drug can be used in pre-diabetic, diabetic, with obesity, without obesity, they are checking everything. So they have chosen an ideal model for pre-diabetes and they have checked and they have ruled out whether it is effective or not. And they have found out. POP model. So now in that they are planning to look at the mechanistic endpoint as I suggested. So they are looking at the plasma DPP-4 activity and activity of GLP-1 level in the chronic treatment. Yes. So is it enough? We have did lot many tests based upon the mechanism, based upon the response by looking at the gold standard marker in the obese diabetic model, in the pre-diabetic model, in the non-obese diabetic model, everything is done. Now we need to show the feedback mechanism also. Okay, so they have added another one criteria. So alogliptin increases the plasma insulin and decreases the plasma glucagon. So there is no like positive feedback is ebbing. So this feedback is little bit drug mediated homeostasis is happening. So they are proving that also. They have defined the feedback endpoints here and determining whether it is doing it well are good, and they found out that the feedback mechanism endpoints is also doing well. Next, they have not only limited with that, and they have also looked at the pathological endpoints. So in pathological endpoints, when we look at the pancreas, obviously the insulin need to be high. Yes, they have did, and they have found out that intense insulin staining was observed in islets of OBEB mice treated with allogliptin. So it stimulates the insulin secretions. So in the pathological ground, in the biomarker ground, in the disease condition ground, they have proved all their claims they have made in mechanistically in response in pathological endpoints also. So whenever we define an experiment, always try to map and correlate, have the sense how it can be applicable or how it can be meaningfully translated to the clinical one. Don't confine your knowledge on or confine what is available doing something, and just this data, the data which we produce won't be having the translational value, then it is of total waste of time, because time is precious. Next comes the drug metabolism and pharmacokinetics. They have died in Sparingo-Dorvi rats, beagle dogs, and then the monkey, higher animals. And they have found out that the THOF is 6, and then their bioavailability is also greater than 80%. So whatever criteria they have posted, everything is matched here. So likewise here, you can see the pharmacokinetic parameters, the single doses. So, and they have also profiled whether it is doing any enzyme inhibition or induction or the substrate for any of the cytochrome P450 enzymes. And whenever you plan for the drug-drug interactions, you always first go and administer the drug which is already available for that indications. Then you can proceed with other drugs. So in terms of safety pharmacology, yes, it's a very big field. The safety pharmacology need a separate session to address on that. Everything is codified in ICH. You can very well know that. You can very well go and have a look at it. So in safety pharmacology per se also, there is no CNS, cardiovascular or pulmonary toxicity. Genetic toxicity, no cholesterogenic effect, no chromosomal aberrations. And in chronic toxicity, dose up to 900 milligram per kilogram and 200 milligram per kilogram in dog. It's also not doing anything. So likewise, they have come to the clinical translation after doing all this test. They have finally come to the IND, and they have gone for the approval for the clinical translation. And initially they have performed the pharmacokinetic study with a single dose in healthy volunteers, whether it is following the first order kinetics, zero order kinetics, and how the eliminations, all these things. And single dose in healthy volunteers, then they are coming up with the endpoint, what it is doing with the DPP-4. So with the healthy volunteers, they are trying to find out, and they have come to a conclusion that, so no dose limiting adverse effect, how much dose we can fix, and then allogliptin was absorbed rapidly, and then total area exposure, and the Cmax, what is the time, the pharmacokinetics, whether it is consistent or not, DPP-4 inhibition is consistent or flexible. So all these things they have ruled out, and finally they have went for the phase 2, phase 3, and finally this drug is in market now. So finally, thank you for listening to this consistent lecture for 1.5 hours, 1 hour. So I can end up with one message that understanding the basics is easy. If you have to question how and why, after that only you can able to appreciate the nuances. Okay, so they used to say that understanding the basics is easy, appreciating the nuances takes years. So thank you for listening, and any questions you can ask me now. Damodaran sir, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you for the wonderful question, sir.
Thank you.
Students, you can ask any questions. Attendees.
Sir, there is a question.
Yes.
What is the importance of molecular dynamics study over molecular docking?
Okay, we should molecular docking, if you take molecular docking where, yes, In dynamic environment, we should always check the stability of the complex, because whatever you do with the docking, where the receptor is kept rigid and the ligand will be made flexible and it will go and orient in that core space. So that is actually not happening. So you have to look at how that interaction is stable, whether it is stable or not, where are in the dynamic environment, where you will give the solvent similar to that of the water system, and then atmospheric pressure and the temperature, and we'll make that complex to get vibrated in that environment, and make sure that even in that environment, this ligand and the enzyme complex are intact, and they are not. Then only we can claim that yes, it's having a very good binding, and you can also able to calculate the binding free energies and other things. In that per se, it's very important. Dynamics is important. Whatever you predict in docking, the next level of validation is dynamics. So from low validation to higher validation, like that.
Sir, there is one more question.
Yeah.
First, the appreciation is there. Thanks, sir, for the useful presentation. How to repurpose the total drugs to a defined target? Any clue? Any online or free software? Can you suggest?
See, the list of repurposed drugs is already available in Drug Bank. Okay, you can go and download the FDA approved drugs, which is they have compiled and they have kept it ready. So only thing is you have to prepare that, and then you can go for online docking tools or many. You can use it. So the drug in terms of FDA approved drugs is there. So you can download and you can prepare and you can use it for drug discovery. It's already there. So it's very easy. It's in Drug Bank. .ca. So one site I am telling you, or many sites are having the repurpose out of drugs, which is, and the strategy to repurpose is, there are many strategies to repurpose. So first you need to have a, if you look at the structure based drug discovery, so you need to have a very good idea about the binding sites, interacting residues, and then excluded volumes. All this comes into the picture when you plan for the repurposing. Yeah, because drug pleiotropy exists, there is no doubt in it. Yes, repurposing holds the importance. After repurposing, you can further go for lead optimization. That is also one of the strategies adapted. Yes.
Sir, there is a participant. Tejas, sir, I think you can unmute yourself and you can ask the question directly to speaker.
Okay.
Hello, I'm audible.
Yes.
I have a question. Like, there are tools for checking the molecular docking, but are there tools for checking the pharmacological tests, like we perform for dose response and in silico testing models?
Yeah, there are tools to predict
virtual model, animal models.
So tools to pharmacological model. Yes, CellSAP model is available. I don't know whether it is freely available or not. They have defined or they have codified the complete CellSAP model. And secondly, in terms of tools, what I understood from your question is whether is it able to predict the targets? Yes, target prediction is available. So you can use BindDB, where you can, they will predict the target and they will expose you. If you have the list of metabolites, you can upload and you can, that will predict to an extent of different targets where possibly it can bind. Yes, BindDB is one where you can do the target prediction. Yes.
So I have a question.
Yes, please.
Should the researchers of traditional medicine focus on the development of new drugs or validation of for the classical formulation?
So you are telling that traditional medicine, and what's the relativity between traditional medicine and modern medicine? Am I right? Your question
yes.
is like, yes.
Yeah.
The higher transformed variant of the traditional medicine is the allopathic system of medicine. Okay. So how is the question now? So traditional system, they always define that this plant will reduce the thirst, this plant will increase the urination or whatever it may be. For example, I'm just telling you. So they will be giving the symptoms or what symptoms can be rectified. What are the symptoms? Or they'll give, for example, in traditional system for diabetes, they'll claim madhumegha, which means that, yes, it will be the urination will be high. Megha means, and madhu means the glucose in that. So these are the indication they will list it. We have to correlate with all this. So what are the plants they have listed for that? We have to take that plant, try to understand what are the metabolites present in that plant. If you have, since we have the list of classical targets, you can first do docking. Since you are, if you are a student for your study, you can do docking and you try to find out with the clinical inhibitor how it is happening. And you also, you can also look at the interacting residues. If you are really much interested, then the top secondary metabolites you can check, or any unique metabolites if it is present, you try to synthesize and you to try to validate in the cell line, and you look at whether it is improving the insulin secretion or not. So like that, different kind of strategies are available. So from the crude extract, the crude way of treating the drugs, now we are finding out which is actually contributing and how it is contributing, how precisely we can engineer those chemicals, because those chemicals, the plant-based chemicals, will have less solubility, or it will drastically impact the pharmacokinetic parameters, how well you can engineer to make them both pharmacodynamically and pharmacokinetically well and good. So like that, you can engineer and then you can proceed. So there are more amount of strategies are involved. Yes, it's I can say it's from traditional medicine. It's a transformed variant. They have taken to the next generation of the traditional medicine. That's allopathy. This is what I believe and what I understood also.
Sir, but should we choose production of plants or materials? Like, which goal is better to produce drugs, like practical and technically?
Plants or? Another one you said? Plants or?
So, what should we choose for production of plants or materials? Like, which goal is better to produce the drugs?
So, from materials, that will be time consuming. So, once we know the structure of that chemical, why I should wait? Why I should take the humongous amount of leaf and making the plant extract from that, isolating the compound is time consuming. No, rather if I know the chemical reaction, let me do everything in the lab. It's time consuming and I can also make a mass production. We can also validate the structure. So yes, it's more modern, no? More technological advancements. Yes, in that per se, I can say that both are same. But that is time consuming, large amount of raw material, energy drain and wear is there. So this is simple. We have to use the technology at one point of time. Yes, they are using technology.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, welcome, welcome. Thank you for your question. Damodaran sir, any other?
We can go towards vote of thanks.
Yes.
And
sir. Actually, I would like to thank you on behalf of all the participants for your wonderful explanations and for the questions posted by the participants. And distinguished dignitaries, my dear colleagues, and other all participants, and now we are at marching towards the end of the today's seminar. It is my honor and privilege to conclude this session by extending the vote of thanks. First of all, we are very much thankful to the management and the inspirational source, our Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Reina, and also Pro Vice Chancellors Dr. Sundaresh sir and Dr. Kadambi sir, for their continuous encouragement and support in conducting this kind of webinars. And on behalf of all the faculty members of the Department of Pharmacology, I thank our Dean, Dr. S. Bharat, for his all-round contribution to the Faculty of Pharmacy with his proactiveness and valuable guidance. And we are really fortunate to have our eminent speaker today's webinar, Dr. C. Jaikant, sir. And in spite of his busy schedule, he agreed to deliver this talk. And we are very much thankful to you, sir. And in your discussion, I think you have covered many points. And in that particular, you have started with compound selection, target choice, typical compound criteria in research, and lead generation and strategy. And also, you have explained something about research testing cascade. So in which you explained about tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 concepts. And also you explained with some case examples, critical success factors in which you have mentioned about the absolute criteria and the relative criteria, and how to define the endpoints by taking examples with alogliptin as an example. So there are many informations that we gathered, sir. Really, it was wonderful explanations for each and every point. And on behalf of Department of Pharmacology, Faculty of Pharmacy, and all the participants, I profusely thank you for your thought-provoking speech, sir. And I wish to express my heartfelt gratitude to Mrs. Gauri Nair, who gave welcoming remarks, and for introducing you in the beginning. And I would also like to convey my sincere appreciations to Mr. Damodar Naik and also Dr. P. Parasuraman for helping us in identifying you for this wonderful webinar. And on my personal behalf and on behalf of Department of Pharmacology, Faculty of Pharmacy, I profusely thank all the participants for their active participation, support and presence in making this program a noteworthy success. So thank you one and all. And if you have any questions or any clarifications, so I request Jaygant sir to share your mail ID and phone number. So you can share your questions. So in future also, you can have touch with him for any doubt and also to improve your research knowledge. So thank you one and all. Thank you very much for your time, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And one more thing on the added up note, I sincerely render thanks to you, sir, and then Gauri Madam for the awesome introduction about me, and Mr. Damodaran for the congenial coordination and everything. And on the above, I also render my sincere thanks to Parasuram, sir, for inviting me, the first person to call me and say, are you free on that day? And I'm so happy that we met and we have wonderful contacts, and future we can move ahead. And students, if you have any doubts, if you seek collaborations, I'm always available. So sharing of knowledge is very important. So always we'll go hand in hand. And thank you so much, everybody, and Ramaya University for inviting me to render this talk. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. We'll meet again.